We've all been there, staring at the blank page. You want to draw something, but something doesn't come out. Or if it does, within a few strokes of the pen, you're ready to tear out the page and start again. It could be a case of the old art block, and there are three main causes of it for me, which we'll chat about in this video. Somebody asked me about this after a recent live stream. They wanted to know how to prevent art block and what to do if they came down with a bad case of it. Now, this is no uncommon experience. I see this question come up in many of the art streams that I watch. A bunch of fellow artists here on YouTube have great videos covering the topic, and they get thousands of views, so clearly it's something that we all go through at some stage in our journey, often more than once. So I thought I'd share what my experience has been of it and what's worked for me. While I waffle on about the topic, I'm going to put up a time lapse of a painting I've been busy with so that you don't have to look at this for the next 10 minutes. Now, a note on that before we jump in, this painting is far from finished. Between a lot of company work to do and a few of the factors that we're going to be chatting about in a moment, this is the first personal painting in a little while that I've really been able to get stuck into. I had a rough idea of what I wanted to paint, but I wasn't quite sure what I wanted to look like, so I did some thumbnails and then just kind of went along with it. It seems to be changing quite a bit through the process, which I'm finding interesting, and even though I don't have a clear idea of what I want the final piece to look like, I'm really enjoying the process of finding my way there, so I thought I would share where it's at. Anyway, let's get into the topic of the video. Right, so the main question is, why is this happening? Why do so many of us experience this art block thing? Most of us used to draw with freedom and excitement as kids. We'd grab our crayons and spend hours drawing because we wanted to. What happened between that point and now, where we struggle to put pencil to paper, brush to canvas, or whatever the case may be? I think there are a few possible contributors, and there are three main ones for me beyond getting decent sleep, exercise, and eating well. Maybe only one applies to you, maybe they all do. Also, it could be that what plagues you could be part of a deeper issue, so keep that in mind and consider getting some professional assistance with your mental health if you need to. The first thing, and it's been a big one for me over the years, is confidence. Confidence in myself, confidence in my drawing ability. Even though I've been at this for a little while, I still get those feelings of, am I good enough to call myself an artist? Am I good enough to be successful and support myself and my family with my art? Am I good enough to make an impact with it? I think these questions already point out the difference in that drawing and painting isn't just about having fun anymore. I've chosen this as my livelihood, my career. I've attached a lot of weight to the result of my efforts. That's neither good nor bad, but it can bring about some challenges, especially with an activity that used to bring so much joy. And it should still, even though it can be hard work. I'm going to get to that hard work point in a moment. How did we get here though? What I think happens for many of us is that when we draw something as children, we'd go and show somebody. We'd get a positive response, perhaps some encouragement, perhaps our painting would go up on the fridge or frame for our parents' desk. They might have nurtured our efforts by getting us more crayons, fancier pens, and we'd draw more. Enter your school years, you're figuring out how to fit in. People see that you can draw, maybe well enough to be known as the person who can draw really well in your class. Maybe people started asking you to draw something for them, their favorite Dragon Ball character or their dog. Maybe they'd even pay you for it. It's pretty validating stuff, right? Your social status, how you fit in, your worth within the rest of the tribe is slowly becoming intertwined with your drawing ability. Again, this is neither good nor bad, but there is potential for motivation to shift and ego to mess with things. Are we drawing because it's fun? Because we're good at it, maybe we're getting paid for it, or because it helps us maintain our social status or popularity. It's probably a mixture of all those things, but it can start to lean a little too much to one particular side. Then you add social media into the mix and things get a little more complicated. I'm sure we've all experienced this where you put a lot of effort into a drawing or a painting, you're feeling good about it, this was definitely a step up when compared with other drawings you've done, can't wait to post it, and so you do. 2 likes. What? Was it not good enough? I really thought this was good. Maybe you try again and spend a little more time in the hopes that this next piece will do better. You don't post much during that time, the algorithm pays a little less attention to you, and when you do post your next piece, that doesn't do your confidence an inch of good. But it doesn't help that we've placed so much importance on those likes. That validation from people that we have no connection to. Perhaps we need to place a little more importance on whether or not the piece you just finished is noticeably better than the last, and if not, maybe we need to focus more on learning rather than gaining social media popularity. Learning is hard work though, for sure, it can be tedious, but if you can learn to love the learning process and not see your failures as a bad thing, you're going to find it easier to sit down and work at it, and your skills are going to grow much faster. I know that's all much easier said than done, but think of it like a video game character. Every exercise, every drawing, every quest gains you experience. With more experience, you level up. As you level up, you need more XP for the next one. So you need to take on tougher challenges to craft fancier items. If you stick with only doing the easy things, you gain very little and it will take forever to level up. But the cool thing is, even if you accept a quest and you fail, you still gain the experience and you can go try again. Maybe then it'll just be that little bit easier to do. Now if you're younger, you're earlier on in your art journey, don't worry about finding your art style just yet. Focus on understanding the fundamentals, how values, light, color, and perspective work. Style will emerge later. Your task for now should be to get good and build a solid foundation. Later on, you can apply those skills to conquer new quests in your unique playstyle. So again, if confidence is a struggle and you feel like your skills are lacking, learn. Do an online course if you can, follow some tutorials. There's no shortage of free resources here on YouTube. Going beyond the basics, do some still life painting. This has been great for me recently because I'm not attached to a particular idea that I'm trying to communicate or to create something that represents my artistic identity or anything. It's purely about learning, trying to understand what I'm seeing and represent that accurately or in an interesting way. And while you learn, no doubt you're still going to be going online and seeing all the amazing work that people are posting. You scroll and scroll, hoping for inspiration, looking for fuel for your next artwork, but something else starts happening. Content overload. This is the second major contributor for me to art block. The internet is amazing, but oh hell's bells can it be terrible for you, especially social media. There's so much to see online, games to play, YouTube rabbit holes to go down, tutorials to follow, series to watch, and the constant stream of news. But the thing is, when you're consuming, you're not creating. Consume too much, and you could soon realize just how far behind you are. And maybe you've just seen so much that you don't know what to do with all that visual information. In a nutshell, two things really get to me. One is, of course, just the sheer amount of awesome art you can access in an instant, one after the next. It's difficult not to compare yourself to this, especially because we're only seeing a small part of the big picture, right? Mostly finished pieces. And so the confidence issue comes up again. Are you good enough? Maybe you're not, and maybe you're being a little unfair on yourself too. What we're not seeing is the struggle behind the work of our favorite artists. We're not seeing their history, we're not seeing how much is being demanded of them to perform at a high level. We're not explicitly aware of their determination to succeed and the reasons behind that. All of this could be wildly different from our own situation. So that destructive comparing is a little bit pointless. That said, it's also really good to be aware of the level of work that people are making out there, and come to terms with the fact that there will always be more to learn, and there will always be people much better than us at doing certain things. This is important for us to keep growing, but also for art to remain dynamic and evolving. So first, to address the impact of that content overload, we need to rethink how we consume content. Not just look and go, wow, that's cool, scroll to the next piece, but unpack why we like it. What makes it cool? Get analytical about our wows. I'll get into that a bit more in the next point. The other part of this content deluge is seeing just how messed up the world is. It is wild out there. On top of what we have going on in our private lives, we are bombarded on social media constantly with nonsense hot takes by people unqualified to speak on a topic, another ridiculous TikTok challenge that makes us wonder how we ever made it this far as a species, AI, the death of ethics, and the grifter's delight, and the endless stream of news and other media reminding us of just how batshit crazy things are. Oh, and the climate crisis and all that entails. We're doomed, aren't we? Now, I'm getting a little carried away here. Madness and stupidity is loud, but it's important to remember that there are people doing and making really cool things, working hard to inspire change, having important conversations where it matters, not on Twitter. So the second thing we need to do, and it's not an easy one, instead of just scrolling in horror, we need to step back, take a digital detox if needed, ditch the social media for a while. We want to be informed but not get caught up in the madness. Do get mad, but then do something with it. And this brings us to the third element of art block for me, not knowing what you want to say or what you're really into. Not knowing why you want to create can make it pretty difficult to know what to create. When it comes to a serious artwork, I need to know what I'm trying to say. I need to know what I want to share. Or I need to have that specific cool thing that when I look at it, I just have to paint it. But why? I think art, whether it be drawing, painting, videography, sculpture, whatever, it needs to have some purpose on a personal level. Yes, drawing is fun, but there's more to it. There's a reason you want to pursue a creative act. Maybe you haven't figured out what yours is yet, and that's okay. But then it's time to start asking some questions. It's time to discover. Curiosity is the key to your creativity. I should put that on a t-shirt. Get to know what you're into, and then don't just consume it. Ask questions and start creating around it. Asking why, asking how, what happens if this, did you know that? Then the artist starts to become something more. An inventor, a scientist, a storyteller, an explorer of real and imagined worlds. So find your why. From there, things get easier. It'll be easier to stay motivated while you learn and struggle when you know why you're doing it. But what if your why is to tune out the noise, escaping the madness, creating your own worlds because this one is, well, yeah, we've already covered that. This is also totally fine. More than fine, it's valuable. Escape can be a bigger indulgence of imagination. When you share that imagination, you show possibilities, you invite others to dream. It can help us cope with the now and move us towards something better. And putting the time in, the effort, the refining of your skill to fully represent your world, that time and effort shows that it means something, it gives it value. This is why I think AI and machine learning can't really replace artists. It's definitely going to affect the art world and the entertainment arts, we can't really deny that, but the relative lack of time and effort, aside from all the other problems of the technology, cheapens the vision. So as someone who enjoys illustration and painting, for example, why should I care about some generated image? I don't, it's painfully boring to me. But if you've been pushing your creative and technical abilities to show something, now that's interesting. That's what makes your work really valuable. And that's why I'd be more likely to buy from you or to follow your journey. It matters more to me because it mattered enough for you to invest significant time into it. Blood, sweat, and tears. Keep going. If these things have been bugging you, good, they should. But try to turn it into fuel for that creative fire inside of you. And come back to your why. I have to remind myself of this frequently. Take a step back from all the content out there from time to time, whether it's good, bad, magical, or horrific, so that you can get on with creating rather than just consuming. As a bit of a bonus point, if you don't know what to do, try something new. Is that another t-shirt slogan? This can be a really good way to shake yourself out of a funk. Try a totally different material or medium from what you're used to, even if it's unrelated to art. Actually, I definitely recommend that you have something, a hobby, an activity, an interest outside of art. I think this is one of the best starting points to get you out of your art block. Within art, one of my teachers at art school would force some of the students out of their comfort zones like this. There were a few people who would always do very tight and tidy drawings with a sharp pencil or a pen. So she would then give them a thick stick of charcoal to draw with instead. Here, do something with this. It's pretty much the complete opposite as a drawing tool to a pen. It's messy, you make thick lines, and it can be more frustrating to get control over. But it's new, and you have to change your approach. Breakthroughs can happen. So give something like that a try, especially if you've been working in much the same way or with the same tools for a very long time. If all you do is paint, try some 3D modeling. If you only work digital, try traditional. If you're a beginner battling with confidence or new to digital painting and struggling to stay motivated, maybe you just need some easy wins. This video is getting a little long, so I'll chat about this topic with some exercises in another video soon. That's all from me in this one. I hope you found this helpful for dealing with those bouts of art block. And if you did, don't waste any time. Go grab a pencil, get curious, and get drawing. Ciao for now.